It's big. It's dramatic. It's more than 300 meters tall. Any higher, it would interfere with jet aircraft. To build a skyscraper of this size, it takes hundreds of millions of pounds. A head for heights, and a talent for hustling.
Everything's a risk. You don't want to take risks, sit in an armchair and watch daytime television.
It takes new techniques, unorthodox methods, and the sheer bloody-mindedness to fight flood water.
That is a disaster.
That's what should happen.
And ice-cold winds from Siberia.
If the wind blows, we're stuffed.
It takes nerve, skill, and some luck. This is the inside story of the battle to build the Shard. May 2012, the Shard is almost complete. It's the tallest building in Western Europe. It took more than 1,500 construction workers 4 years to build. Nearly 12,000 tons of steel frame and almost 50,000 cubic meters of concrete. The construction of the Shard faced a series of unique engineering challenges and pioneered radical techniques never seen before in the UK. With exclusive access, this is the story of the building of the Shard. The Shard began as the dream of maverick rag-trade millionaire Irvine Seller. He made his fortune with fashion stores, including Mates Clothes.
So that's where my first shop was, the Black Corner one.
Aptly, the name of the Carnaby Street his and her boutique, run by Irvine Sellers, is Mates.
It was phenomenally successful.
Seller made and then lost a fortune in property development, but he bounced back.
Irvine hadn't had the greatest record. Bog standard retail parks, regional office buildings, shopping centres, nothing remotely like this.
In 2000, Seller announced plans for the tallest tower in Europe. The first design was for a 365-metre skyscraper, but this was quickly rejected by Seller.
I thought the guy was a complete joker. I didn't think he had a hope in hell. I thought he was a dreamer. It wasn't just me, everyone in property thought this was a loony idea.
Seller was undeterred.
All hopes of progress lie with the unreasonable man, and I am unreasonable. The reasonable man accepts it can't be done and therefore doesn't try. The unreasonable man won't accept that, tries and often succeeds.
To realize his unreasonable dream, Seller needed a world-renowned architect. In March 2000, he met and hired Italian Renzo Piano, designer of the New York Times building.
We went out for a restaurant and we started to talk about this desire to make something there, very tall.
And he said, you know, I'm not a fan of tall buildings. I find them aggressive, phallic symbols, fortresses. I thought this may have been a wasted trip. And he saw the railway line, he saw the river, and he began to sketch on the back of this menu. This was done in seconds. He saw it as a sail coming out the water. And I thought, this guy's really got style.
The Italian architect designed a tapering tower of angled planes of glass. There are 25 floors of offices, 22 floors of a hotel complex, spa and restaurants, then 13 stories of luxury apartments that will sell for tens of millions of pounds each. The entire structure is crowned with a steel-framed spire that supports a pinnacle clad with shards of glass. Designed to blend seamlessly into the sky. The area around the Shard is also being developed. The total cost of the entire project is £1.5 billion.
You can't build cities for a small amount of cash. You might build the odd mud hut, but if you're going big then you've got to think big.
In 2007, the world banking crisis led to the withdrawal of funding for the Shard. After a tense interval, the project was rescued by new funds from a consortium from Qatar. They need to install paying tenants. With funding and the design in place, the challenge is to build it as quickly as possible. The first challenge that the builders face is that the site is little more than 5,000 square meters, wedged tightly between other buildings. What makes it particularly difficult is that on one side is Guy's, one of the capital's major hospitals that handles 750,000 patients a year. On the other side is London Bridge Station, Britain's fourth busiest rail terminal. And close by are the underground tunnels of the Jubilee Line. When Seller bought the site in 1998, it was occupied by a 25-story office block, rather grandly named Southwark Towers. It had to go. The quickest way to knock down a building is to blow it up. But with Southwark Towers, this isn't possible because of its location. Demolition begins in May 2008. 25,000 tons of concrete and glass have to be removed before building work on the Shard can begin. It has to be taken down floor by floor, piece by piece. More than 14,000 cubic meters of concrete and rubble are removed from the site in 1,100 truckloads. At its peak, the building comes down at a rate of one floor every week. The removal of this giant weight of concrete and glass will destabilize the soil below.
Just like when you remove your foot from the wet sand on the seashore, all the sand moves in to fill the gap immediately. Well, that's what happens with buildings as well.
The movement of the soil threatens the stability of nearby buildings. In fact, any structure within 80 meters of Southwark Towers could be affected. Engineers install special movement sensors on all nearby buildings. A bank of computer equipment is installed to monitor each building 24 hours a day for any dangerous movement. The slightest shift of a nearby building will trigger an emergency alarm. Engineers watch closely as the monitors show that the adjacent Jubilee Line tube tunnel moves 15 millimeters during excavation. This is significant, but is within safe limits. Though the tunnel moves, it is not enough to disturb the underground trains. Later, when the Shard is completed, the tunnel gently moves back by 4 millimeters.